The Odicheck Mimiko. Her Excellency, the wife of the Governor, the Deputy Governor, permit me to recognize all other stakeholders in the affairs of Adia State, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. And as a government in the last 3 years under the Labour Party government, we also together chart the way forward using the binoculars to gaze into the realistic future of possibilities. This gathering is not just an ordinary talk shop, but an indispensable communication process in democratic governance. Our first executive governor, the late Sage Pam Michael Edekwele Ajashi, when harassed by the military junta, put democracy succinctly, "You talk, I talk." This is the whole essence of participatory governance. The freedom to communicate, exchange views and ideas freely without inhibition about the affairs of the state, as no single individual is a box of knowledge. Therefore, we shall in a short while take a cursory look at how we have fared so far, and thereafter tap into the wealth of our mind's creative ability to collect. Having not just a say, but an input and direction as to what development option is most desirable for them. You are all living witnesses to the fact that the people at the grassroots.
The next item on our schedule is goodwill messages. As soon as we're done with that ordering, we will invite certain personalities to the microphone to deliver the goodwill messages.
Man, I was introduced as a friend of Ondo State. I should like to collect the Master of Ceremonies. I cut my political teeth in Ondo State. So I am still tied to the umbilical cord of Ondo State. Let me say, Mr. Governor, and to the people of Ondo State, that I'm here this morning highly elated for what I've witnessed in Ondo State in the last few years, 2-3 years. My constituency is Yoruba land. Those who know me here will know that I was the pioneer Assistant Secretary General of Yoruba Council of Elders to Justice Thompson and later Secretary General. I have witnessed tremendous development here, particularly in all fields. And I've had cause to ask Mr. Governor how he has been able to do it. Now I want to listen, I've come to listen to all those state stakeholders to have their own assessments. But I want to say without any fear of contradiction, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, that there is government in action in Ondo State. I am a particular lover of people-oriented governance. And what I have witnessed in this country in the last so many years is elite-centered governance. But in Ondo State, we have people, masses-oriented governance. And Mr. Governor, if we want to make a headway in Nigeria, where even federal government statistics says 70% of our people live below poverty line, it's only a people-oriented government that can make a headway. I congratulate this government. I congratulate the people of Ondo State. I congratulate the Yoruba people, because this is our pride, our own beloved treasure, in whom we are very pleased. Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, for the next goodwill message, I'd like to invite the national president of all Nigerians resident in Ghana, Mr. Albert Bayo Ashalu, to the microphone.
His Excellency, Dr. Mimiko, Your Royal Highnesses, people of Ondo State. Well, I'm honored to stand here to witness the life-changing program in this state. It is amazing because in Ghana, where I heard the people of Nigeria, what we always heard about Nigeria is never do well people, prodigal sons, people who have every resources and they are living like a beggar. But when I got to Ondo State a few days ago, I can see that there is heaven in Ondo State. Heaven come down in Ondo State. Ondo State has now become a reference point for every Nigerian living in the diaspora. We can now be assessed that Nigeria too, we can do better. Because in Ghana, they believe that the only thing we can do is the leader who are massive wealth to themselves and go and put it in another man's country while leaving the people of the state in poverty and agony. But when I got to Ondo State, in fact, the difference is the case. I can see that the people of those states are now living like kings and queens. In fact, when I'm privileged to drove to the market of Ondo State, I spoke to a few market women. I realized that there is joy in their system. They are happy. They are really living like people of a great nation that Nigeria represents. So I will congratulate our governor. But I will say one thing, that how do we, I mean, duplicate this great change to every nation of Nigeria so that we can be able to answer the name that they know us for as giant of Africa. Thank you.
That's about the last goodwill message we will be able to take in this segment of the program. We will move on to a special presentation, a video presentation of the happenings in Ondo State in the past 3 years. But while they are getting ready to roll that, I'd like to quickly recognize the editor-in-chief and managing director, the news magazine, Mr. Bayon Onuga. I'd also like to welcome the General Manager, Operations, Channels Television, Mr. Kaede Akintemi. The video presentation will begin now for the next few minutes.
The First Lady, Deputy Governor, Honorable Minister, I stand on existing protocol to save time. Permit me, before I make this presentation, to express our thanks for all of you, especially those that have found time to travel out their domain to be here with us. And I can see many of you from Abuja, from Lagos. Although the compares may not have recognized you by name, the good Lord recognizes all of you. I want to thank you for being part of this. I want to especially thank our royal fathers. They have always graced our occasions with their royal and majestic presence. I thank all of you. God bless and honor all of you, sirs. And I want to say this straight away, that what I'm about to present actually is not a video presentation, a PowerPoint presentation. We're trying, Aki and his team, Adara Mola says I have 30 minutes or 1 hour to make my presentation. So I will only have to run through all of this. Because part of the difficulty we had was choosing what will be appropriate for this presentation. Every department of government wants a piece of the action, and each of them will tell us, especially in council, that they deserve a pride of place if we're making any presentation on the transformation that has taken place in this state through the hand of God in the last 3 years. So what we are presenting actually is a resume. We have left out quite a number of areas, but in the course of the interactive session, we will be happy to address any issues raised or any critical omission that you think we have that this presentation suffers from. But I want to tell you straight away that I'm also happy to make this presentation, and that is very important. At inauguration, we promised that we will work for the people of this state. 3 years on, this is a resume of a scorecard. In terms of physical development, we are active in every major town in this state. We are working in not less than 400 communities in the suburban and rural areas. God has helped us to make our impact in every sector: education, health, housing, urban renewal, tourism, sports, and all. And our landscape is dotted all over with developmental progress, at least physical, going on. But permit me to say that what we have considered our greatest achievement in the last 3 years cannot actually be adequately represented here. At inauguration, we said that there was a disconnect between the government and the governed, and that we will set out to ensure that we bridge this disconnect. As I stand here speaking with you and the people of this state, I guess we bear testimony to it, that to a very large extent, when those state people are not only proud of their government, they feel part of government. And for us, that is the greatest achievement. And that takes off from the mantra and belief that it is only the people themselves that will drive development. All we can do is to create the enabling environment, catalyze the change process, so that everybody will reach out for its own individual and collective and corporate creativity to create the state that we deserve, to create the state that God actually destined for us. We are destined to be a great state in a great nation. And like I always say, we hope to be number two in Ondo State. We are number one to be number one in everything. Having said all of this, I just go ahead to make my presentation. Well, this is Ondo State. Most people are familiar with it. That is where we are, where in the southern, southwestern part of Nigeria. 18 local governments. We were created 3rd of February 1976. We were 36 years old. Our geography: we have a land area of 15,000 square kilometers. We are oil and gas producing state. We have luxuriant vegetation. We boast of perhaps the widest variety of vegetation in Nigeria, from the southern wetland, the mangrove vegetation, through the thick rainforest, you go up north to savannah. There are not many states that have the privilege of that range of vegetation. We have a decent coastline, and approximately by the 2005 census, so I think we're 3.4, but we will be close. We'll be closing in on 4 million happy people now. Extensive fertile, like I said, savannah forest, but we remain the largest producer of cocoa in Nigeria. We remain the largest producer of cassava in Nigeria. And we have embarked on an oil palm revolution that in the next couple of years will make us the number one oil palm producer in Nigeria. Of course, we have cashew and all of the other abundant resources. Every state has one form of exotic granite deposit or the other. Looking back, when we came on board, this was 14th of December 2006, when they declared a desire to run for governor in Ondo State. And we went through a torturous route to get here. But all through the tribulation, the people of Ondo State stood like one man and said, this mandate must be retrieved. God answered that call. On the 23rd of February 2009, by landmark judgment given by the Court of Appeal in Benin, we retrieved our mandate. And that is the swearing-in ceremony of the governor. This is very important because it also captures the unprecedented outpouring of love and emotion, the crowd at inauguration. This is one inauguration that gave me a lot of trepidation. And at inauguration, I was telling my God, wow, how does one human being meet all these expectations? But God has been very, very faithful. And we demonstrate that. Amen. Like I said at inception, we set out to address the following essentially: mass unemployment and excruciating and evident poverty all around us, dilapidated infrastructure, city slum, underdeveloped agricultural sector, industries that are dead, moribund. The World Bank came and told us that we had the worst maternal and infant mortality indices in the Southwest. We had a nil motivated civil force, and like I said, there was a palpable disconnect between government and the governed. Strategic direction. We spelled out that vision clearly from the beginning to make Ondo State the best administered state in Nigeria and the signature of all eyes, of which all its citizens shall be proud, where equity, justice, and fairness shall be the driving forces of government action. With a mission statement to mobilize the people of Ondo State to harness all our God-given resources, create and use wealth for the ends of individual happiness, collective fulfillment, and peaceful cohabitation in an environment of transparent and honest leadership. So many words, but as we go ahead, we'll see. We crafted our 12-point program deliberately with the acronym A Caring Heart. We decided on that acronym as part of our strategy for people to know that government is about them. And the government is the big brother. The government is supposed to protect everybody. Government is supposed to have a caring heart. Government is supposed to be concerned especially about the marginalized people in society, those who remain statistics, but the government who never had flesh and blood. So we crafted an acronym, A Caring Heart. And going through the gamut, it's about agriculture, food security, community-driven development, aggressive capitalization of our land resource, roads and infrastructure, industrialization, no to poverty, gender equality and women empowerment, healthcare and housing, education and capacity building, artisanship development and empowerment program, rural development, tourism, sports, and youth development. I could remember when we came on board, especially when we were crafting this, there were people who argued that the best strategy would be to pick two sectors and do our best in 4 years, that there was no way we could do an integrated transformation of the state. But eventually we settled for this. But I tell you, and I give God the glory, that on this list, 12-point program, there's not one of them that is begging for attention 3 years on. And deliberately so, because for us to have a holistic development, it must be multi-sectoral. And that is what God has helped us to do in the last 3 years. Recalibration of governance structure to achieve more effective response to the administrative sector. And we deliberately developed a mantra which would define our new work ethic. I said, before we came on board, and that applies to most parts of this country, our philosophy and mantra over the years, especially the last 20, 25 years, has become Ishe Kekere Owun Lanla. But we needed to change that for people to know that the dignity of labor, hard work, brings prosperity. And there is no shortcut to it. And that is why we adopted the mantra Ishe Lugunshe, Ishe Takun Takun, Ibukun Rekpete. Once there is Ishe Takun Takun and Ibukun, the prosperity follows. That is the Ondo State mantra. And I feel excited that our people have keyed into it. On the street, every village, every hamlet, every community, people know the import of Ishe Takun Takun And I'm very happy. And I say that I can hold this up as one of our critical outcomes in these 3 years of engagement. We also needed to rebrand, to create a new image for the state, something cosmopolitan. We wanted to take Ondo State off the provincial perception to a cosmopolitan 21st century state. And that is why we came up with this unique logo, Ondo State, Ishelogun Ishe, with a combination of colors that radiates joy and vibrancy, and the green stands for agriculture. And each of these strokes represent each of our federal constituencies, and we have 9 of them. Again, it radiates sun because we are the sunshine state. This is the new image, deliberately to rebrand the state. Working for the people. Let's talk. I'll just pick each sector and just run through what are the critical areas of intervention in the last 3 years. Like I said, this is a bird's eye view. It also presents to you. If anybody needs the details of any of this, any of the commissioners, even outside of this, on a continuous basis, we'll be ready to provide you with any details that you want. But for the purpose of this presentation, I just want to give you a feel of what it has been in the last 3 years. Our goal clearly stated food security and provision of raw materials for industry, clearly defined agriculture for food security. And we said that our industry policy will be agro-raw material biased. And in the process, we hope to use agriculture as a tool of employment and wealth creation. And we defined the strategies. At what point do we intervene to be able to achieve this? And we decided on 2 critical areas. Number one is input support, subsidy, or what the minister now calls growth enhancement support. But we thought that input chemicals, tractorization needed support, because everywhere in the world you have to support agriculture. And we also found out that we needed improved seedlings to our farmers to be able to improve on their productivity. We then repositioned the Agri Input Supply Company to an agency in 2009. 18 farm service centers, these are one-stop service centers for all inputs that anybody, any farmer desired to purchase, of course at very subsidized prices. But beyond these, we also found out that occasionally a farmer from the hinterland wants to buy, say, a 10,000 naira worth of input. Some have to travel from their location to these farm centers at the local government headquarters. At the end of the day, we found out that this may not be too cost effective. So we created, in 2010, mobile farm centers. And now we see the picture of this. That will actually take the input to the farmers where they work. That our input subsidy scheme, we increased the quantum of money, we increased it from 41 million to 200 million. And we deliberately gave 30% subsidy on all input chemical, including fertilizer, and for hardwares like cutlasses and files, 50%. To date, we have expended over 630 million naira in subsidy in fertilizers. We also instituted a produce buy back scheme so that we can maintain price and continue to sustain the enthusiasm of farmers. We have produced and distributed, produced 1.5 million cocoa seedlings, and to date we have distributed over 1 million. We brought in 1 million Malaysian stock oil palm seedlings, and they are the orange nursery now ready for distribution and planting. Through this, we hope it's part of our oil palm revolution. You all recall that Malaysia came to take their seedling from here in this country. As at 2008, they make more money from oil palm than we make from oil and gas combined in Nigeria. And so And because they have, over the years, through science and technology, improved on their seedlings, we thought it was time to go get some of their seedlings. And from what we have seen in industries, they are definitely better than the seedlings that we have in Nigeria today. Well, traditionally, we have also produced 200,000 palm seedlings and all these seedlings for distribution to farmers. The Ondo State Laurentiis Foundation School, we have revamped it, invested in it, so that our young school leavers can be trained in modern agriculture. We are doing a semi-mechanized abattoir in Akure. A 1 billion commercial agricultural scheme put together by the federal government, we have keyed into it. To date, we have disbursed 688,003,754 beneficiaries across the state. And of course, we are also active in the FEDAMA program. Farm input supplied. These are mobile farm centers, what I'm talking about. And now moves around so that those who are interested in purchasing little quantities of people will not have to travel to the local government headquarters. These are the mobile farm centers, two types here. Like they go around the state. This is the ongoing semi-mechanized abattoir in Akure, because we found that many of you, if you know the condition of the abattoir, you will just vow not to taste meat. So we thought that as part of our integrated agriculture and development program, this is a pilot mechanized abattoir in Akure, which we hope will be completed very soon for commissioning. This will serve definitely as a model for many other parts of this country. In the natural resources sector, raising of seedlings has been a priority for reforestation. We have raised 1.8 million thick and indigenous tree seedlings. We have planted 1.5 million thick and indigenous tree in only 795 hectares of new plantations. I'm sure you saw the picture. Of course, we have also maintained existing plantations and 920,000 seedlings of ornament cultured trees and all of that. This is the North Tree Center in the Kare, where we raise this is the indigenous tree seedling. These are seedlings in Oyimo Forest Reserve. And I think that the National Conservative Foundation came to Ondo State and branded our nursery one of the best in the country for reforestation. Because the trees we cut today, those trees are the product of the efforts that some people made 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. So as we exploit our forest resources, we are also embarking on aggressive reforestation, so that in 20 years down the line, our children and grandchildren will have trees to cut, exploit for commercial use. Part of our Greek is the Wealth Creation Agency, which is meant for acceleration of the pace of wealth creation in Ondo State through agricultural innovations and aggressive promotion of small-scale enterprises. We have established 3+1, and I will explain, agro-business cities. One in Oreno, Igbo local government, Ekpe in Ondo East, Auga in Akuku Northeast, and we are revamping an old farm settlement in Iswada, in our local government area in the north. Simply put, the whole idea, we want to attract young graduates to farming business and to let them know that farming or agriculture can be business and product and profitable, and to create a conducive environment where they can live, as if they are in the cities, and engage in mechanized farming. and take farming as business, and in the process tackle the problem of unemployment and also create wealth, because we deceive ourselves. I keep telling our people, the biggest challenge we have as a generation of politicians is mass youth unemployment. And to be able to tackle it effectively, we must leverage on areas where we have competitive advantage, and agriculture is an area begging for exploitation. Now that is what we are exploiting to generate job for our young school leavers. And I will show you an example. This, the first batch of 1,087 graduates, we call them agro-businessmen in Ore City. They're all excited. If this was not still, you will hear them singing, Ishe Agbe, Ishe Ilewa, Eni Kushishe, Umajale, Iwe Kiko, Lai Sioko, Ati Ada, Koipe, Owe Koipe. Some of these kids have said on in interview that they will never exchange what they are going through now for any government job. That the white collar people can keep their job. There's one of those girls who is doing fish farming, engaged in fish farming in Ore. She read French. And when National Orientation Agency came to interview him, I think Difaru, she said, look, even if you give me a job in French embassy, I won't go. Now I speak French to my fish and they respond. The interesting thing about all this, all the agro-business cities that we built, whether we build them through in-house efforts, all the technology, including the dam that supplied more than 200 ponds through gravitation, were all designed and built by Weka in-house technology. I just wanted to know that. This is during construction. This is one dam. This dam serves 250 ponds in Ekpe, in Ondo's local government. No power. It's so constructed that only gravity drives it, and it supplies water to 250 ponds. Each of those ponds capable of giving full-time employment to the university graduate. This is Ore. In Ore, we have two big reservoirs, like I said, two dams built, and 200 ponds. These are example of the ponds. The Ore fish ponds are already very active. This is training them. This is it. We use copens, and it's a bit on the high end. But one area where we can add value later is local production of feeds. This is from Ore. Okay. Thank you. Sunshine catfish from agro-business city Ore. We call them farm settlement. And let me tell you one secret. We call them farm settlement. And the Minister of Agriculture said, look, don't call them farm. When you say farm, people don't associate farm with prosperity and business. See, that's why we call them agro-business city. That's Minister of Agriculture for you. This is Sunshine Catfish from Ore. Yes. Now we also, apart from fish farming, some of the kids are also engaged in poultry farming. We have more than 35,000 birds in Ore. My information as at last week is that in Ore, these graduate farmers produce an average of 300 crates of egg every day. People just branch off the express and pick them up. From Ore town itself, some people book 2 weeks ahead for the Sunshine Agro-Business City egg. And these are participants. I will explain, it's critical. These are not employees of anybody. They are participant owners. They own the farm. What we give them as input, we amortize over time us, they make profit from the farm. And the amortization program is deliberately made for them to feel comfortable and to know that agriculture can be a prosperous endeavor. Now we are also leveraging on in the north, in the Auga Cocoa Farm City was also designed as a cattle ranch. So we are doing fish farming, crop farming, arables, and a cattle ranch. And let me tell you, the first set of calves are there already, with feeding pens, with big reservoir. And the way it goes is, the graduate farmers are allocated their own cattle. They feed, and at the appropriate time, they will sell and make profit. Later, we hope to bring exotic semen from Argentina or wherever, inseminate these people, and create a dairy industry in Auga Akoko. And we are very optimistic. Our target and goal is that every household in the Auga axis will have its own cattle that they will milk and make money from. And it's doable. The next 2 years we will get it done. Now, Ishwada is a peculiar story. Right inside the jungle in Ishwada used to be an old coffee farm settlement built by Awolowo in the 50s. But of course, it's completely abandoned, run down. We stumbled on the place and we said, we must revamp this. We stumbled on the place around October or so last year. I said, let's do some quick win. What can we do in the interim before the end of the year to make money out of this? And what we did was that we found out there were old chicken pens which we renovated, allocated to some graduates, and brought in broilers. 7,000 broilers at Ishwada. And by Christmas, we were selling broilers. These graduates were selling broilers. There's an old, this is, we are even adding value. We added value through a processing plant owned by the Fagway Groups, abandoned, which we paid some stipend to renovate and use. So these were the broilers that the farmers, now the 268 graduate farmers, sold their broilers last Christmas. By the grace of God, next Christmas, you will eat Ishwada Agribusiness City chicken all over Ondo State. Where tractorization has been emphasis, the great attraction of these agribusiness centers to our young graduates is that these are farms where you hardly need to hold a cutlass. Everything is mechanized. These are the cross section of the tractors in one of the centers, I think, already. This is the oil palm nursery, the Malaysian stock, 1 million of them. This will plant more than 10,000 hectares of oil palm plantation. And we think that this will be the beginning of revolutionizing agriculture. I am not taking anything away from anybody, but let me just tell you that this, when we imported these seedlings, they are Malaysian stock. In special containers and all of that, we found out that the sprouting rate was 100%. Every nut that we brought in sprouted. But guess what? Those ones that we took from some of our research centers in Nigeria had a sprouting failure rate of 20%. So we still need a lot of work to do. In fact, the Malaysian stock was more than 100% sprouted because some of them had double sprouting. But the ones we brought from our settlement in Nigeria had 20% sprouting failure. These are 70 chalets or hostel accommodation in our farm city. This is where the graduates lived. Again, we built this through in-house efforts. all of them. And they are very modern toilet, clean, neat, with water, electricity. Even they have DSTV and recreational facilities. This is a close-up. Very good, and the kids are very excited about the accommodation. So it's a new city we are building, actually. This one is in Ekpe, in Ondo East local government. We intend to reduce dependency on revenue from crude oil and create a buoyant, highly productive and self-sustaining economy using potentials available in agriculture. We had other more exciting slides on what we are doing in the agro-business city. And we are very excited about the outcome. And you really need to interview the graduates working to show you, to demonstrate the success of this experiment. The three of them have a combined capacity of 3,000 graduates, gainfully employed and creating wealth. And we're not going to stop until we're going to, in this year, we are expanding the capacity of each of these farm settlements and creating two or three others. Community development. Because this program is, for me, is a favorite. I love it because for so long in this country we talked about bottom-up approach to development. But never has a program been crafted on a massive scale to really translate it into actionable programs that will impact the lives of our people. When we came on board to actualize our dream for development at the local government level, at the community level. And I think, as Dr. Kunle said, over the years in this country, there has been inequitable distribution of our resources. It has been skewed on the side of the elite. But majority of our people who live down there, the lower rung of the ladder, have had the short end of the rod. And we thought that we needed to reverse this trend by making choices on behalf of the people at the community level. And the only way we can do this is to create a program that they will key into and take hold of their own development. I'll demonstrate what I'm talking about as we go along. The 3 I's initiative, we just played with words. It's an acronym. The first I is infrastructure. The second one is institution. The third one is industry. And essentially, within these are the three ingredients of development that we need at the community level. Institution. One good thing about our communities is that every community has some form of governance institution. The KBACs, the BALES, the community leaders. So our people are organized. But what we need is to build the capacity of these local governance institutions and direct them in the direction of desirable development. And development, the community will eventually explode in development. Of course, when you talk of development, you talk of infrastructure and ultimately industry, because it is industry that will create the wealth that will enrich the people. The key characteristic focus on rural and community development, participatory governance, community-driven development, bottom-up and top-down support approach. What we did, and I just say summary for those who are getting to know about this for the first time. In 2 minutes, let me explain to you what the TRI initiative is all about. It's about, we started off by training some of our graduates. We call them volunteers, and we call them very good names. They are community change agents. We brought some NGOs and experts in community engagement to train them. And when we train them, we deploy them to our pilot communities to engage the communities, identify the governance institutions in those communities, then get the communities to get together and say, what are your priority areas in development? Get them listed out, prioritized through election or whatever process. And because over the years, our people have lost confidence in government, then pick priority number one, and in cooperation with the communities, quickly put it on ground. That's why we call it quick wins or confidence building projects. I think 2-3 days ago we were at somewhere in Akoko. Oyin Akoko. When we got to Oyin Akoko, when our change agents got to Oyin Akoko, it's Kabi Esi here. And Kabi Esi also testified to the fact that they eventually chased them out. Say, Etuano, Eni Yoba, you will do this, you will do this. Where they were tired of all of this. They didn't cooperate with our community change agents. It took the permanent secretaries, ourselves, Mrs. Kolawole, to go there and convince the KBAC to give us some leeway. So the community change agents interacted, they decided on their list of priorities. And they said the number one priority of the 10 programs they listed was the community town hall. Now for 20 years they have been struggling with the community hall. There was a time they levied everybody to pay 1,000 naira. At the end of the day, the thing was abandoned. And for 20 years, they never went beyond the window level. And since they came, that as their number one priority, our team went there and redesigned the town hall. Lo and behold, 2 months after, the town hall was ready for the use of the community. That classically demonstrate why we call them confidence building programs. Now, 4 days ago when we went to commission the health center, town hall, the KBAC and the whole community danced and rejoiced to welcome us. And the next stage is now to get people from the communities that we call community change champions, elected by the people themselves. We brought them to Akure and now trained them. Community account keeping, project implementation, monitoring, evaluation, how to prioritize. Then we send them back to the community. And they will serve as a focus of community development. And once they start on any of their own programs, what we now do is now disburse cash directly to them. Since they already have community account, and they go ahead and develop projects themselves. And we have clustered communities. And in this cluster, we identify the raw material that can be used to drive industry. And for a cluster, we put a cottage industry to create wealth for the people. And this program, there's ownership, there's development, and this is the way to go. And we are very excited about our outcome. We have invested over 3 billion naira in these communities in the last 3 years. Of course, this is much more than what has been sent in community development since the creation of Ondo State. We have trained 160 community change agents. We have done baseline survey and need assessment for 305 communities. We have 425 confidence building projects, out of which over 300 have been completed and are functional. We have carried out capacity building for 1,220 community change champions. These are change champions elected by the people themselves. And in the first tranche of direct disbursement to communities, we disbursed 73 million grand to survey projects that there are eligibility criteria. And my information is that the communities have completed this project beyond what any contractor would do, no cutting of corners, and very soon we'll go and commission this project and also grant those communities more funding for them to scale up their own development. Like I said, in 9 clusters, we are going to put another 9 micro industries in place in the year 2012. This represents the sectoral choices of the people when they took their votes. 98 wanted basic health centers, 103 projects, water pump and water supply, 29 deep wells, 17 solar powered water supply, open stall, locked up cottage industry, road, and all of that. Interestingly, 64 people in the community, 64 community asked for town halls. You would never have imagined the centrality and the importance of town hall. But come to think of it, even our great grandfathers, in front of every palace, you will see a big tree, either an almond or a big tree. Those were the town halls of those days. So 64 people, 64 communities opted for town halls. And we are, I'm sure we must have completed, we must have completed more than 20-30. And they are all state of the art with water and other modern facilities. These are community change. These are kids, these are unemployed graduates that we trained to be community change champions, change agents. I believe it when we say they are change agents, because they are properly trained. ICT, GPS, they are really productive young men and women. And they some of them have never been inside the communities, and they came back and said, look, we now appreciate the real value of our education. What difference we could make in these communities? Because they lived in the communities, in the process of engaging the communities. They are change agents. And we are deploying them to many, many areas of intervention. And they've done so wonderfully well. I'm very proud of them. This is the man that drives the program. As the commissioner. He's done so well, so well. And this is the special assistant on community development NGO and others. They are driving the progress, and we are very proud of the outcome.